that's a different kind of apology.
That's modern.
Well, I mean,
so aren't they saying we shouldn't be sorry?
That's where we're starting. The time-honored question.
Follow the man. We spin the route. If there's a local guide in town, someone who's been to Larissa, take his advice. Let him lead. Either that, or we can just hack our way through.
I thought there was some artwork or something.
You brought yours?
No, it's that Carolyn's.
I'm not sure I
color-coded pencil. And
I didn't have time.
And you were going to go.
You did it instantaneously?
Yeah, it was.
Oh, I'm sure glad Sandy's there. I can finally get her picture.
Hey! What's
your name?
She always sat behind the light.
19.
Or I sat in front of the light, Sandy.
You've got a little disappointments tonight.
Don't make up my mind for me. Don't take me for granted.
Okay, what we need to ask is, in the time that we've had since the last exploration, any strategies occurred to you that you want to test on? Going around? You said Karen?
I don't have any strategies.
Paul?
Not other than I said.
Ron Dostey?
No.
Sam?
One of Sam.
What did Ron
say? I said, if there's a man who's been to Larissa, let him leave. Or let's just hack our way through it. Why isn't it what?
We may get there, but it may take so long.
Well, if you don't have a guide, you haven't been there yourself.
You need a guide, man. You really need a guide.
We need a lot of machetes.
Well,
you work with what you have, right, Joel?
That's right.
If you don't, you get a lot of it.
Obviously, the only thing we're going to do is read.
This is a good spot.
Obviously. Isn't it?
Yeah.
That's what we're going to end up doing.
May I ask a question? A strategy to do what?
Oh, to explore from this point to the end of the dialogue to go through the tail end of Socrates, isn't it?
It's going to map that whole thing out, that whole, all those channels and the thiel and the right region, the soccer ball and the... And what that means,
mm-hmm.
And the groves of the gods.
Right.
And the rivers.
Oh, God, the rivers are really...
And whether Tartarus runs all the way through,
yeah.
And how come those forces keep moving when there's nothing in the center?
You had mentioned, we mentioned the last time that it was like the serpent power from the moon.
That was just a flippant remark to someone. I don't know who it was.
Yeah,
PG.
Probably,
yeah. Something like that.
Well, you know you never pay any attention to those remarks. They never pan out.
Well then, okay. I'll tell you what we try then. The story takes off, its departure line, that if the soul is immortal, then there's one big consequence. That if we neglect it, the danger appears to be terrible. So that's okay. Now, what can we do with that? If neglect, so what he's doing is he's starting that if you neglect it, and the end he gives you a charm. He says this is the charm. So this is the way to take care of it. So the whole thing is an image, and it becomes a charm. All right. We certainly know where that is, don't we? If someone wanted to jump to it. At 114 DE. All right, then we'll have to see what the meaning is of the charm. Because that's, as it were, the antidote to this. Then neglect, if we neglect it, it's terrible. If neglect, the soul consequences are going to be terrible. Now he's got to do that very thing. He has to make clear why he says that and why it is that this can be the charm. Whole goal. So if we can go from, look here, that's only, how foolish of us to take such a small section. It's only 7 pages.
And the letters fall in sequence.
Right, and the letters fall in sequence, quite true. All right, and going back. But since the soul is seen to be immortal, it cannot escape evil or be saved in any other way. It can't be saved in any other way. Right. Can't save it. In any other way. Right. We call this the salvation, the concept of salvation, Platonic philosophy. Unless we make it as good as possible and as wise. Good and wise as possible. Therefore, the condition for the charm is that it must fit those two. It must lead to wisdom, making it as wise as possible and good. It must. So therefore, he now starts off the story. Would you not agree? This is the background. And this is quite interesting. We need a. I'm reading for us. At D, page 371. Soul takes with it to the other world nothing but its education and nurture. And these are said to benefit or injure the departed. From the very point of its departure through the entire journey. Now, that paideia is education, and that's the word that Socrates uses in the 7th book of the Republic when he talks about the condition of man's nature, the degree to which he could be said to be enlightened and unenlightened, according to Jowett, or educated, uneducated. It's a peculiar word, right? It means more than just school learning. So, nurture. Whatever you've done in your, this is development. It's what you've learned, this is your development. That's what you take with you. So your journey starts from that point. So then I guess we should put it over here, just to be. Take your education and all that you've learned.
or nurture. And that starts your journey. Now there are two and possibly three guides and four, as it would be, divisions, depending upon how you read it. So why don't we go right ahead and sketch it out. Yep. Yeah, I darn near heard it. Robin, did you? Who had one? I heard one. All right.
I thought in this section.
Okay, why don't you read it then? Okay. And so it is said.
For the soul, is that?
Yeah.
For the soul takes with it to the other world nothing but education and nurture. And these are said to benefit or injure the departed greatly from the very beginning of his journey hither. And so it is said that after death, the tutelary genius of each person to whom he had been allotted in life leads him to a place where the dead are gathered together. So that would be one life. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Then they are judged and depart for the other world with a guide whose task it is to conduct hither those who come from this world. Oh, that's the same guide.
Could be.
Yeah.
That depends on just how you read that one word.
Okay.
So that's why we have to be careful and go back to it later. Right, these are the right ones.
It's because I kind of sound like a conductor.
Yeah. Or it depends upon what the second guide is, but there's a special guide whose task it is to conduct either of those who come from the school. Right. So it could be one or two, that's what I said.
Okay.
In any case, right, let's say that's the division.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that's the division that marks the world.
The world. From this world.
Right. And let's use this one mostly.
I don't think that second guy is referred to as a guide. I think he's referred to as leader, hegemonos. The first one is a daimon, tutelary genius, so, you know. But it's hegemonos, I think, is the second one. Which is leader, you know, if it's leader, it's that word.
Leader leads him, right?
That, I think it's just that same word, or to lead him, as in the cave, too, I think. I think. I'm pretty...
Why don't we give that to you and run it down? Because that would be really worthwhile.
Yeah.
Shall we push?
Okay. And when?
No, it is. It's hegemonos. It is.
Which is?
It means lead.
The second one?
Yeah, that's as he says, guide.
Mm-hmm.
Right, because what he's done, he's translated other world. That's Hadon. Hados? Hades? He's just translated it as other world.
Mm-hmm.
Hadon. Meta hegemonos. See that? Right at the E there, meta hegemonos, I guess.
And And when they have received their due and renamed to the time appointed, another guide brings them back after many long periods of time.
And that's a hegemonon. And the journey is not as Telephus says in the play of Aeschylus, for he says...
Oh, hold it, just one moment.
Okay.
I just wanted to indicate that that's a problem. When they receive their due and remain through the time appointed, another guide brings them back after many long periods of time.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Another God, right, so that's the second. Right. Now, the problem with that also is it's not clear whether he brings them back to this point where they were collected or back into a reincarnation.
Yeah. Right, back so to the judges?
Yeah, so that's open.
Yeah.
Right, so I just want to leave several things open while mm-hmm. we pursue this.
This is the soul with the education.
What's he doing with his hands, Pierre? Your guys.
What's he got with him?
Well,
on the other side of the line?
You know, like this. No, he's like this. Both of them.
Got a walking stick.
Oh, that one down there. Oh.
Both.
Oh, the other one does too. I see.
He's Irish.
No, I didn't put him on the right. You should get him. That marks him.
He's an Irishman.
Right. Show the Irish.
Says in the play of Aeschylus, for he says, a simple path leads to the lower world, but I think the path is neither simple nor single, for if it were, there would be no need of guides, since no one could miss the way to any place if there were only one road. But really, there seem to be many forks of the road and many windings. This I infer from the rites and ceremonies practiced here on earth. Check one. Mm-hmm. Now the orderly and wise soul follows its guide and understands its circumstances, but the soul that is desirous of the body, as I said before, flits about it and in the visible world for a long time, and after much resistance and many sufferings, is led away with violence and with difficulty by its appointed genius. Mm-hmm. And when it arrives at that place where the other souls are, the soul which is impure and has done wrong, by committing wicked murders and other deeds akin to those of the works of kindred souls, he is avoided and shunned by all, and no one is willing to be its companion or its guide, but it wanders about alone in utter bewilderment during certain fixed times, after which it is carried by necessity to its fitting habitation. But the soul soul that has passed through life in purity and righteousness finds God's companions and guides and goes to dwell in its proper dwelling. Now there are many wonderful regions of the earth, and the earth itself is neither in size nor in other respect such as it is supposed to be by those who habitually discourse about it, as I believe on some of the foreigners.
Okay, now, say, that's another guide. It's a third guide. And there's a question about whether this one has one or gets one.
Nobody wants to.
Yeah, but there's a line there that looks like he finally does encounter the genius.
Well, I was reading it that he wasn't getting, he was carried by necessity.
Yeah, but is led away with violence and with difficulty by its appointed genius.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah.
So then we have, this is the circuit for the one above. This is that extra guide. And now, the gods are companions and guides for that top man. Mm-hmm. Okay. The thing that we're going to pull out of this is this line. That this is an important learning. So this is learning. The whole thing is learning. You've got a companion and a guide. It's going to understand its circumstances. That is, where it's going, what it's doing. So this is high learning, because its circumstances are going to be living with the gods, companion with the gods. That's real learning. That's more than three units. What do you mean, Socrates? I read a good deal about the earth myself. But not what you believe. So I should like to hear it. The word belief through this whole thing debates the mind. It's not sympathetic as it is in the Republic, which we'll get to so on. The dictionary is something we can see.
Stokes and Ty, isn't it? Opinion.
Yeah, it should be done, yeah. But, I think it's convinced. Mm-hmm. Persuaded, convinced.
Let's see, as I believe on some means it is true.
I think that Dosimaya's habitually discourse about it.
No, that's the lega. Mm. The lega.
Is it?
Yeah, I think this is the supposed to be, isn't it?
Yeah, excuse me, supposed to be, that's better. Mm-hmm. Oh, we'll pick it up several times throughout, so let's see what word is used.
Sure.
Well, Simeus?
Sherry? Mm-hmm. I do not think I need the art of blocks to tell what it is. But to prove that it is the true world, I think, be too hard for the art of godliness, and perhaps I should not be able to do it. Besides, even if I have the skill, I think my life, Simeus, will end before the discussion could be finished. However, There is nothing to prevent my telling what I believe the form of the earth to be and the regions in it.
Okay. What are we going to get? Yeah. So he's going to understand the circumstances. Now he's going to announce he's not going to give a discourse on it. Now there are many wonderful regions of the earth, and the earth itself isn't even in size in other respects such as it's supposed to be by those official discourse about it. That's all else is authority. Figure, why earth? Why earth? Because what we're going to get is going to be really quite a splendid view. In any case, remember, no, let's hold up. We'll merge by itself. Well, that'll be enough.
I am convinced then that in the first place, if the earth is round and in the middle of the heavens, it needs neither the air nor any other similar force to keep it from falling.
Okay, I want to take this out now. I'm going to just play with that. This side.
Okay. But its own equipoise and the homogeneous nature of the heavens on all sides suffice to hold it in place. For a body, which is an equipoise, is placed in the center of something which is homogeneous, cannot change its inclination in any direction, but will remain always in the same position. This, then, is the first thing of which I am convinced.
Okay. Would you agree? He has a general statement. That is to say, he's making a statement about the earth. And then he's saying, hey, you know what's interesting about me? It's equally true about a body. Right? So he has a parallel, doesn't he? He's got a parallel. So the same principle he's giving for this, he's going to give for the body. Bigger. You see the two sides of it? For a body which is in equipoise and is placed in the center of something which is homogeneous cannot change its inclination in any direction. So, if the body can be, right, look here, if the body can be in a similar position, if the body can be in a similar state, a similar result will occur.
It actually leads to this one does not say body.
Yeah, what is your route syndrome?
Ground and middle have to leave nothing to keep it from falling.
A thing.
But what? A thing. A thing in equilibrium. In the middle of something which is everything in the last
okay.
Line.
No. Right, so we can apply it. Mm-hmm. Wait, let's start. So.
Mm-hmm. This is the first thing I'm convinced. Secondly, I believe that the earth is very large and that we who dwell between the pillars of Hercules and another faces live in a small part of it about the sea. Like ants and frogs by a pond, and that many other people live in many other such regions. For I believe there are in all directions on the earth many columns of various forms and sizes into which the water and mist and air have run together. But the earth itself is pure and is situated in the pure heaven in which the stars are. The heaven which those who discourse about such matters call the ether, The water, mist, and air are the sediments of this and flow together into the hollows of the earth. Now we do not perceive that we live in the hollows, but think we live on the upper surface of the earth, just as if someone who lives in the depth of the ocean should think he lived on the surface of the sea, and seeing the sun and stars through the water, should think the sea was the sky, and should, by reason of sluggishness and feebleness, never have reached the surface of the sea, and should never have seen, by rising and lifting his head out of the sea into our upper world, and should never have heard from anyone who had seen how much purer and fairer it is than the world he lived in. Now I believe this is just the case with us, for we dwell in a hollow of the earth and think we dwell on its upper surface. In the air we call the heaven, and think that it is the heaven in which the star and think that it is the heaven in which the stars move. But the fact is the same, that by reason of our feebleness and sluggishness, we are unable to attain to the upper surface of the air. For if anyone should come to the top of the air, or should get wings and fly up, he could lift his head above it and see, as fishes lift their heads out of the water and see the things in our world, so he would see things in that upper world. And if his nature was strong enough to bear the sight, he would recognize that is the real heaven and the real life and the real earth.
Okay. Remember what we're saying. Whatever can be said for this can be said for this. That's why you set it up, didn't you? Right? So then you have an analogy. All you have to do is fill out the your side of it. Just as our...
Pardon me, what were you saying? Whatever can be said for what can be said for what here?
Yeah.
I have to get a cup of coffee.
Let's call it just as the earth is described from this principle, we can then assign the same things to this side, which is a thing, which is us, which is the body. Agree?
Mm-hmm.
So, just as the earth is described by Sock, so too can our existence be described. All we have to find out is what is the difference, and we can get that right from what we read. That the earth itself is pure, right? The earth itself is pure and is situated in a pure heaven. Right? Earth is pure and situated in a pure heaven. Everything we say to the one, we can say to the other. Then he has a whole description. Now we do not perceive that we live in the hollows, but we think we live on the upper surface of the earth, just as someone who lives in the depth of the ocean should think he lives on the surface of the sea, and seeing the sun and the stars through the water should think the sea is the sky. Right? And watch this language. And should, by reason of sluggishness or feebleness, never have reached the surface of the sea, and should never have seen, by raising and lifting his head out of the sea into the upper world, should never have heard from anyone who had seen how much purer and fairer it is in the world we live in. Right? So that the image we have then is,
he's got that mix there, doesn't he?
Pardon?
Doesn't he have that mix like sluggishness and feebleness? Should that go in there with the analogy of being in the sea?
Yeah.
Yeah, because
yes.
He says it.
Yes.
Down.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
Good.
So from here, I've got to get above the crud on LA. Yeah, perfect vision. Smogville. Okay. So he has a kind of a meaning, right? He has a secondary analogy, right? Just as the fish and aquatic animals can be described as seldom being able to lift themselves out of the sea to see what our world is like, so we, in the same way, live in a world where very few of us, because of our feebleness, ever work hard enough to get a look above the atmosphere of our world to see what the world really looks like. So he's got a mean going on, doesn't he? Right? Agree? Agree? And that's that great principle, which is a lot more used in philosophy classes. Right. Fish, right? Seldom stick their head up, right? For some curious reason. Because they think they're living in the right world.
This
but if they ever got out and took a look, oh!
This is weird. Somebody was saying this is the Marianas Trench. You know, they've never even met anybody who's been above.
That's what this never.
Yeah. You know, the deepest part of the ocean, right, where those fish are, that are psychedelic ones with the neon eyes.
Okay, then from here, that's going to be, to use the language, this is going to be pure and more beautiful. Agreed? You get it? I'm on the top of 377. And should never have heard from anyone who had seen how much pure and fair it is in the world we lived on. I believe this. I believe this is just the case with us. Just the case with us, analogy. For we dwell in the hollow of the earth and think we dwell on its other surface. And the air we call it heaven and think it's heaven, which the stars will. But the fact is, the same by reason of feebleness and sluggishness. That's why we're stuck. Alright? Feeble, sluggish. That's a constant theme, by the way. Remember in the symposium? What do you get for that final step, the third beginning?
Strength therein.
Strength grow and have strength, gain strength therein. Right? And that's what's required for that trip. So that's what's required. And therefore, we're unable to attain the upper surface of the air. For if anyone should come to the top of the air, it should get wings and fly up, he'd lift his head and take a look, just as fishes, blah, blah, blah. That's the other part of the analogy. And if his nature was strong enough to bear the sight, he would recognize that this is the real heaven, the real life, the real earth. And that's the real heaven, real life. That's what he would be saying. Everything could be said here, Ken. Same thing. Now he goes back into the analogy, right? Goes back into the side of it and says, in our existence, nothing is perfect.
That is to say, because we're looking this way. And therefore there's nothing perfect. Because the brine and all that stuff causes great damage to the things. So we're that's that same image, that there's nothing wrong, we're just turning in the wrong direction. Nothing at all really to be compared to the beautiful things in our world. But the things in that world above would be seen to be even more superior to those in this world of ours. So therefore the relationship is that this is superior to all here in this world. Right? Suggest model copy. Everything. There's a superior everything in this world and that world. And that's that famous model copy image. If I may tell a story sometimes about the things on earth that is below that one and what they're like, it's what we're hearing. Now, what do we have to do now? We have to see what it's like. We now need a picture, and that's what he's going to give us. This is not a picture. Right? Because this is general, and now we're going to get a picture. Right? So, it's from this viewpoint, this vantage point, that we're now going to describe.
Above is said to look like those balls that are covered with 12 pieces of leather. It is divided into patches of various colors, of which the colors which we see here may be regarded as samples, such as painters use. But there the whole earth is of such colors, and they are much brighter and purer than ours. For one part is purple of wonderful beauty, and one is golden, and one is white, whiter than chalk or snow. And the earth is made up of the other colors likewise, and they are more ennobled and more beautiful than those which we see here. For those very hollows of the earth, which are full of water and air, present an appearance of color as they glisten amid the variety of the other color, so that the whole produces one continuous effect of variety. And in this fair earth, the things that grow, the trees and flowers and fruits, are correspondingly beautiful. And so too the mountains and the stones are smoother and more transparent and more lovely of color than ours. In fact, our highly prized stones, sardis and jaspers and emeralds and other gems, are fragments of those there. But there, everything is like these, or still more beautiful. And the reason of this is that there the stones are pure and not polluted or defiled, as ours are, with filth and grime by the vapors and liquids which flow together here and which cause ugliness and disease in earth and stones and animals and plants. And the earth there is adorned with all these jewels and also with gold and silver and everything of that sort and that sort.
So, would you agree what we're trying to get is the countries are all comparatives. And you have to line up the comparative for everything said. Right? Especially watch the conclusions. Mm-hmm.
finished, we could ask, what is it like? What is it like viewing from the top? Top of it all. That's the question we're working on. The contrast.
For there they are in plain sight, abundant and large, and in many places, so that the earth is a sight to make those blessed who look upon it. And there are many animals upon it, and men also, some dwelling inland, others on the coast of the air, as we dwell about the sea, and others on islands, which the air flows around near the mainland. And in short, what water and the sea are in our lives, air is in theirs, and what the air is to us, ether is to them. And the seasons are so tempered that people there have no diseases and live much longer than we. And in sight and hearing and wisdom and all such things are as much superior to us as air is pure than water, or the ether than the air. And they have sacred groves and temples of the gods in which the gods really dwell, and they have intercourse with the gods by speech and prophecy and visions, and they see the sun and moon and stars as they really are, and in all other ways their blessedness is in accord with us.
Okay, make it. Make a contrast. And what do you see?
There's a lot of similarities there, except one side, what we have, theirs is, everything's like in a superlative. It has more, it's brighter, pure.
Right. It's ours is, right, this over here then is going to be brighter, pure, more beautiful.
More transparent, stones and mountains and everything. They have all the things we do, flowers, trees, fruits.
It's whole.
Right. No diseases, right? It's all perfect, right?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. And yet
it's complete.
It's complete, but
well, our stones are fragments of theirs.
Yes, ours is a fragment of theirs.
Theirs is complete.
Right, ours is a fragment, this is a fragment. Or a copy. Where this is the superior, the model. Good. What else would you say about it? Good. More?
Theirs are in plain sight.
Yeah.
Cathartic. It's pure.
In many places. Just looking at it makes you bless.
Right. That's right. Mm-hmm. Right. Therefore, look here. We can put a name on this. We can summarize it in a phrase, can't we? In this realm, there are true and beautiful beings in pure, transparent. life. Right? Agreed? Yes.
That's brilliant.
Yes, that's brilliant. Yes, that's very brilliant.
It's like real crowning, isn't it?
Yeah, that's real brilliant.
And it's just the context for the dialogues with the gods.
Mm-hmm. Right? They have intercourse, speech. Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, that's very specific in your intercourse, speech, prophecies, visions. And it's just not looking, looking. It's
just being there is the condition
for
enlightenment.
Right, my blessing.
No, the look upon it is just looking upon it. That's the conversion of the gospel.
Yep.
Right.
Just even looking upon it will bless you.
Yeah.
Shift now occurs with motion. Right?
I just make sure that I have this clear. Is he talking about down here living on Earth and being able to transcend the regular Earth? Or is he talking about his soul being out of his body and above the Earth?
I take the first and the second on to be different.
Oh, you do? I'm saying the first is he's still living on the Earth.
Yeah.
And the second, his body is dead.
But the separation of the soul from the body is the object of the study. Remember back in 69? Pick one.
69?
Yeah. Death is the separation and release of the soul from the body, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And it's brought about by a kind of yoga, separating from all parts of the body, collecting and gathering together as a habit. Happens both here, both now as well as hereafter.
Okay.
So it's both. Okay, now comes the shift.
Such then is the nature of the earth as a whole, and of the things around it. But round about the whole earth, in the hollows of it, are many regions, some deeper and wider than that in which we live, some deeper but with a narrower opening than ours, and some also less in depth and wider. Now, all these are connected with one another by many subterranean channels, some larger, some smaller, which are bored in all of them. And there are passages through which much water flows from one to another as intermixing bowls. And there are everlasting rivers of huge size under the earth, flowing with hot and cold water. And there is much fire and great rivers of fire, and many streams of mud, some thinner and some thicker, like the rivers of mud that flow before the lava in Sicily. And the lava itself. These fill the various regions as they happen to flow to one or another at any time. know, kind of oscillation within the earth moves all these up and down. And the nature of the oscillation is as follows. One of the chasms of the earth is greater than the rest and is born right through the whole earth. And this is the word which Homer okay. means when he okay. says.
What are we going to focus on? Yeah, but the oscillation.
The oscillation.
See, this is equipotent.
That's
right. And now we're going into, yeah, what's the,
yeah.
Come on, Ken got a good one.
We like the right groove. We were searching for that the other night. And Rhonda found it so quickly, we were just saying that she's a fast reader.
You mean right from the mouth all the way down?
Yeah.
Right through the whole system.
Right through the whole.
Far off, the lowest abyss beneath the earth, and which elsewhere he and many other poets have called Tartarus. For all the rivers flow together into this chasm, and flow out of it again, and they have each the nature of the earth through which they flow. And the reason why all the streams flow in and out here is that this liquid matter has no bottom or foundation. So it oscillates and waves up and down, and the air and wind about it do the same. For they follow the liquid both when it moves toward the other side of the earth and when it moves toward this side.
Okay, let's stay on that principle, shall we? Let's go back to the principle.
No foundation.
Okay, for all the rivers flow together into this chasm, flow out of it again. And they have each the nature of the earth through which they flow. Right? That's the key. Therefore, all we need to know is the particular nature of the earth. And that will give us then what we need. Because that gives the nature to the particular thing. Right? So this is going to be a geography, as it were. So in the same way, for the individual man, we can put everything over here too, can we? Because that was the basic principle we started out with. Here, or we can go here, it won't make any difference.
Back where?
We can go here or here. Yeah, Reeder Creek, for all the rivers.
I'm not sure.
Just under the quote at page 383.
For all the rivers flow together into this chasm and flow out of it again, and they have each the nature of the earth. Which they flow. And the reason why all the streams flow in and out here is that this liquid matter has no bottom or foundation.
See, I shouldn't use this figure because that was the figure. But we'll use it just for the moment. No foundation. The price of not having a foundation. If it were like the earth, it would have equipotence and homogeneity with what is, see, it's homogeneous with what is about it. Right? Since this doesn't have any foundation, then you're going to be like what you are around, heterogeneous. You're going to pick up your nature from the earth that surrounds you. So, all the breathing, all the stuff that's going on, no foundation, therefore.
Flow,
flow, so it oscillates, waves up and down, air and the wind about it do the same. Well, they follow the liquid, both when it moves towards the other side of the earth and it moves towards this center. So it's oscillating, right? Just as the breath of those who breathe flows in and out.
Yeah.
It's going back and forth between the individual and the earth. Go ahead.
So the wind there oscillates with the liquid and causes terrible and irresistible blast as it rushes in and out. And when the water retires to the region which we call the lower, it flows into the rivers there and fills them up, as if it were pumped into them. And when it leaves that region and comes back to this side, it fills the rivers here. And when the streams are filled, they flow through the passages and through the earth and come to the various places to which their different paths lead, where they make seas and marshes and rivers and springs. Thence they go down again under the earth, some passing around many great regions and others around fewer and smaller places, and flow again into Tartarus, some much below the point where they were sucked out, and some only a little, but all flow in below their exit. Some flow in on the side from which they flowed out, others on the opposite side, and some pass completely around in a circle, coiling about the earth once or several times like serpents, and then descend to the lowest possible depth and fall again into the chasm. Now it is possible to go down from each side of the center, but not beyond, for there the slope rises upward in front of the streams from either side of the earth.
To someone who's got, you know, just elementary understanding of the wind.
The basic image of the wind is.
There's a vital energy at the base of the spine. And when once aroused, it proceeds up through the spinal column in a serpent-like movement where it gets its name. And it moves this way, two of them, up the one is called the Ida and the other is Pingala. And the basic principle of Kundalini is conservation, retention of all flows. Breath and any all of the life forces, retention of them, that's the key word they use throughout. Matter of fact, they should do it this way, shouldn't they? Just to make it more appropriate. Because then this whole thing is said to spill over, come crashing into the shashama, the mind or the brain itself. And that's the experience of enlightenment. As it passes through successively, as it rises, it passes through successively six centers. And that's those are called chakras, or centers. So that if someone just for that rudimentary understanding of it, takes this out, and say, well, coiling about the earth once or several times, my servants then descending to the lowest possible depth, fall down to the chasm, and that is possible, go down to the side of the center, but not beyond, for there the slope rises upward and comes from the other side of the earth.
Would Tartarus be then the straight path up?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's the big route.
Not the
straight path.
Out the Brahman.
Up the Brahman.
hasn't been a lot of
notice. Yeah.
Each one of the, what's our principle? Up there on the side? You pick up the nature. Whatever nature you have corresponds to the nature that's passed through. So each one of these rivers has a different psychic state. And that's what we're going to get.
Yeah.
That's a center. Those are centers. That's what a center means.
Oh, like the chocolate center.
That's a chocolate center.
Yes. Yeah.
Seven.
Now these streams are many and great and of all sorts, but among the many are four streams, the greatest and outermost of which is called Oceanus, which flows around in a circle. And opposite this, flowing in the opposite direction, is Acheron, which flows through various desert places and, passing under the earth, comes to the Arcusian Lake. To this lake the souls of most of the dead go, and after remaining there the appointed time, which is for some longer and for others shorter, are sent back to be born again into living beings. The third river flows out between these two, and near the place whence it issues, it falls into a vast region, burning with a great fire, and makes a lake larger than our Mediterranean Sea, boiling with water and mud. Thence it flows in a circle, turbid and muddy, and comes in its winding course, among other places, to the edge of the Arcusian Lake, but does not mingle with its water. Then, after winding about many times underground, it flows into Tartarus at a lower level. This is the river which is called Pyrrhalium, and the streams of lava which spout up at various places on earth are offshoots from it. Opposite this fourth river issues, it is said, first into a wild and awful place, which is all of a dark blue color like lapis lazuli. This is called the Stygian River, and the lake which it forms by flowing in is the Styx. And when the river has flowed in here and has received fearful powers into its waters, it passes under the earth and, circling around in the direction opposed to that of the Pyrrhalium, it meets it coming from the other way in the Arcusian Lake. And the water of this river also mingles with no other water, but this also passes round in a circle and falls into Tartarus, opposite Pyrrhalium. And the name of this river, as the poets say, is Cactus. Such is the nature of these things. Now when the dead have come to the place where each is led by his genius, first they are judged and sentenced, as they have all lived well, as they have lived well and piously or not. And those who are found to have lived neither well nor ill go to Acheron, and embarking upon vessels provided for them, arrive in them at the lake. There they dwell and are purified. And if they have done no wrong, they are absolved by paying the penalty for their wrongdoings. And for their good deeds, they receive rewards, each according to his merits. But those who appear to be incurable on account of the greatness of their wrongdoings, because they have committed many great deeds of sacrilege, or wicked and abominable murders, or any other such crimes, are cast by their fitting destiny into Tartarus, whence they never emerge. Those, however, who are curable, but are found to have committed great sins, who have, for example, in a moment of passion, done some act of violence against father or mother, and have lived in repentance the rest of their lives, or who have slain some other person under similar conditions, these must needs be thrown into Tartarus, and when they have been there a year, the wave casts them out. The homicides, by way of Cactus,
those who have outraged their parents by way of the pyroplegion, and when they have been brought by the current, and when they have been brought by the current of the Arcusian lake, they shout and cry out, calling to those whom they have slain or outraged, begging and beseeching them to be gracious and let them come out into the lake. And if they prevail, they come out and cease from their ills. But if not, they are borne away again to Tartarus and thence back into the river. And this goes on until they prevail upon those whom they have wronged. For this is the penalty imposed upon them by the judges. But, yeah.
Well, it's discourse in some fashion. Right? They have to
prevail.
They have to deal with them. Right? They have to tie some kind of logos, isn't it? Right. Prevail mm-hmm. upon them. Huh?
But those who are found to have excelled in holy things are free from these regions within the earth and are released as from prisons. They mount upward into the pure abode and dwell upon the earth. And of these, all who have duly purified themselves by philosophy live henceforth altogether without bodies and pass to still more beautiful abodes, which is not easy to describe, nor have we now time enough.
But soon it, all these things that we have, we ought to do our best to acquire virtue and wisdom in life, but the price is fair and the hope great. Right? Just a little bit more.
Okay, now it would not be fitting for a man of sense to maintain that all this is just as I have described it, but that this is something like it is true concerning our souls and their abodes. Since the soul is shown to be immortal, I think he may properly and worthily venture to believe, for the venture is well worthwhile, and he ought to repeat such things to himself as if they were magic charms, which is the reason why I have been lengthening out the story so long. This, then, is why a man should be of good cheer about his soul, who in his life has rejected the pleasures and ornaments of the body, thinking they are alien to him, and more likely to doing harm than good, and has sought eagerly for those of learning, and after adorning his soul with no alien ornaments, but with its own proper adorning of self-restraint and justice, and courage and freedom and truth, awaits his departure to the other world, ready to go when the fate calls him. You, Simeus, who seeks and rest, will go hereafter each in his own time, but I am now already, as the tragedian would say, called by fate, and it is about time for me to go to the bath, for I think it is better to bathe before drinking the poison, that the women may not have the trouble of bathing the corpse.
Good. Yeah. You hold it there? Some speech, how do you have time?
Yeah.
To describe you?
God.
How about a cup?
Yes.
We have done some strange work. Pictures?
All been practicing camera work.
Oh. For a cup?
Yeah.
Thank you for reading.
No, that's fine. Yeah, that's fine. Except, let me find Easter.
Thank you.
can't you all the time be the blood or the gold and take the silver or the gold?
Very curious.
Open.
I don't see this model yet in my own mind.
Pardon?
Some features to this I don't see yet. Like it's water, air, ether, and he suggests the higher. And it's in the air that these... It's in the islands about the air, isn't it? That's the surface. Oh, the island's in the ether.
That's the higher.
Well, isn't that what you just described? Above the surface?
Yeah. Well, where are you?
No,
yeah.
I don't know right now. Just working off of memory. Oh, let me find it. Okay, we've got the people who never reach the surface.
Oh, see. What we want to do is work back.
Yeah, that's the way to go.
When we do it, all right?
We're coming down from ether then, right? Well, he suggests the higher though, later. Right where he left off.
Yeah, you're going to the elements.
Oh, okay. I thought you said... Yeah. Well, let's see. Looking backwards. Let's see.
But under this principle, which we got from the chakras, all we need to do is fill that in the qualities here for each of those. And then worry about their geography later. Don't work out the geography first. Because you get them, things get their nature through which. That to which they grow. So, the first group is neither up nor down. Right? They neither do good nor evil. And those who are found to have lived neither well nor ill go to ashram, working on vessels to gather them, riding them at the lake. There they dwell and are purified. And if they've done any wrong, or they're absolved by paying the penalty for their wrongdoings, and for their good deeds, they receive the reward of each according to their merits. So, this
this flows into. I like.
Next is target. Right, those are incurable.
Kind of the greatness of their wrongdoings, just they have committed many great deeds of sacrilege. Wicked, abominable murders. Into this river, never return.
I agree, the second case. Those are curable, right? Because the first group was were incurable. Those have done great sins, moments of passion, violence against father and mother, inflicting repentance for SLRs, or stand some other person with similar conditions, these must be thrown into. These must needs be thrown into Tartarus. And when they have been there for a year, the way to cast them out, the homicides by way of practice, and those who have outraged their parents by way of what flagger upon. Right? So, there are two in here.
The refuse break down about it. Yes. The refuse break into sections like that. Incurable. Eternally ignorant souls.
Yeah, yeah. She could be counted on for that as well. I was, are you sure that they're in the Republic? That they weren't born that way?
Yeah.
Chosen people.
Born incurable.
Yeah. You know, the born part.
That's always giving me a problem. Seems like there's a conflict there with Buddhism, though, and the incurable. That means all sentient beings couldn't be saved, then, doesn't it?
Right.
And therefore, the old bodhisattva is going to have to work his butt off for eternity.
Fruitlessly.
Yeah. It's never going to happen. It ain't going to happen.
Artlessly. Maybe if you recognize yourself.
He likes the wine jug and a stick.
There are some that...
Maybe that's what keeps creation going.
You'll never get the duck out of the pot.
After you, no, after you.
To you, after you,
no. After you.
It's like being a dorm man.
Right.
After you.
Oh, after you.
Shouting out, hey, let me come ashore.
Let me out. Can I come out? Can I come out of the water now? Can I come out of the water now?
No.
Another
dream. Going back to the briar patch.
When they have brought to the current, they have Trucy on the lake, they shout and cry out, calling those that they have slain, outraged, and begging and beseeching them to be gracious and let them come out of the lake. Yeah, they prevail to come out.
Be gracious.
Yeah.
So, decision, decision, procedure. If they prevail, they come into the lake. If not, they go back.
Right.
Right. Got it. And they go.
Loop. Keep doing the loop.
That's back into the river.
Become real good at dialogue.
It goes on and on.
Wait. Right. Don't make your decision yet. Hear my tale.
I'm not convinced.
This is not the time to get the brass rail.
I'm going to prevail upon you before you decide.
Yeah. That's right.
But those who are found to have excelled in holy living and free from these regions within the earth are released as from prison. That, he ain't saying nothing. Okay. Now we go back to 12.
And the streams of lava which spout up at various places on earth are offshoots from it. Opposite this, the fourth river issues, it is said, first into a wild and awful place, which is all of a dark blue color, like lapis lazuli. This is called the Stygian River, and the lake which it forms by flowing in is the Styx. And when the river has flowed in here, and has received fearful powers into its waters, it passes under the earth and circling around in the direction opposed to that of the Pyrophlegion, it meets it coming from the other way in the Arcusian Lake. And the water of this river also mingles with no other water. But this also passes round in a circle and falls into Tartarus, opposite Pyrophlegion.
Now, that one, right? My hand got a little cramped, so it's said I almost draw that last river in.
Or it does a whoopsie do.
Yeah.
Trouble is, I wouldn't want to be in that river.
Boy.
That one, you know. The Acreon is not too bad because it doesn't dump into Tartarus.
Well, yeah, it moves.
See, it's a two-way street.
You can get thrown out of there.
Yeah.
Unless you've been.
It goes right through both ways.
Right. That's right. We really have an interesting way to diagram, but I'll just represent it. And this is the terrible one. Fearful powers. Hey, how you doing? Passes under the earth and certainly ran in the direction opposed to that. Meets it. Coming from the other way into the Anchusian River, the water of this river also means no other water. The name of this river at that point is Sarkis.
Mm-hmm. Okay, why don't we take a break? And do some meditating on it, come back with a beautiful theory to pull it together. But we also need the four elements. Huh? That's rather interesting. Last one.
Are those rivers here? They're
fearful power.
No. I was wondering if those rivers, they're connecting the hollows in the air.
Right. You know, there it is.
So that's in the air, right?
That's in the air. I don't know where it is.
Well, it's like, there's water.
What
you
were doing a moment ago?
Well, what water is to air here. Mm-hmm. Air is the ether there, mm-hmm. and those right, and so those are hollows in the ether, mm-hmm. right? I mean, their air is ether, mm-hmm. and so air. These are connecting air mm-hmm. passages, mm-hmm. right? These are channels between the air passages, mm-hmm. and we're not there in this present state. If we take this metaphorically instead of similarly. We're underwater.
We have this principle going. We've been doing fine with that. But now what he's doing is giving us one side and not the other.
Yeah.
Right? He's not giving us the other.
Oh, yeah. So we worked out, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just trying to see where to start. You know, where's base one?
Well,
like, in where do you place yourself in this model?
No, it has to be in the elements. That gives us the right. Now, the problem would be then, for each of these, could you give a positive
on the other side?
On the side of man, you mean? Or
yeah, on the side of man. This is the negative side.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, there's a higher side.
Oh, definitely. There's got to be some people who haven't murdered their parents.
Yeah.
Not in Greek tragedy, they aren't.
It would be like the Tartarus that they never get out of, and it would be on the other side, the light that they never have to leave. Something like that.
The Isle of the Blessed.
Hypersphere.
Well, how to have it.
Well, then we're going to have all these rivers and dynamics on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because in Book 10 there was a parallel thing going on, wasn't there, in the
Republic?
Yeah, where there was the two different caves, where it was going and coming out of both of them.
We use that prison image in here, being released from the prison.
And there we did, there was coming down and going back, coming out of the earth, and there was four passageways, right?
That's right.
Actually, what might be fun one day to do is to take Republic, Myth of Earth, the Phaedrus, you know.
Yeah.
All of these things. Because they're all dealing with the same issue.
There's that great little book, you know, that Shrine of Wisdom put out, Myth of Soul and Plato. They're all in one book. You know, they put them all.
Quantacosta.
$2.95. Probably about 80 cents to Xerox.
You like that, huh? Break the copyright.
Right. So, like, this is a hypercube kind of model, mm-hmm. Hypersphere, right? That's conceivable. Yeah.
What is a hypersphere?
Well, I don't know, Carol. But a hypercube.
I'm playing video games.
But a hypercube would be like being a box, and it was nested inside of a bigger box, and then each of the vertices are connected. Right? They call that a hypercube, right? And it has some principle, like right angular principle. But I don't know. But the thing I'm seeing is that the surface here is what is like our air is water. He's saying we live underwater, so there must be a surface above our air. That he's saying is ether, right? Mm-hmm. So
that's right.
Right. Yeah. And there's islands there, and there's groves of the gods there.
Mm-hmm. At least three levels.
Mm-hmm. We were seeing the guys by the shore at the
level of the aquatic, uh-huh. Then us, and then what it's like out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they were mentioning the ones that live by the shore of the air, and the ones that live inland. And the ones that walk in the groves of the gods.
Oh, they don't have to worry about getting wet because it's easy, right? They go to the beach.
Philosophers had skin diving shops.
Skin diving at Tartarus is rough, though.
Well. All depends on which group you belong to.
Yeah, yeah. I've heard of hot springs, but this is great.
A little different.
Just watch out, outraging your parents then.
I have a question.
So we live in the water.
Mm-hmm. That on deaf ears, isn't it?
No, I just completed myself.
I got Rod's attention.
You have a question?
Just Gina just mentioned there has been a standing invitation to the ranch for a long time.
That's by heavens true.
And Gina mentioned that there was some discussion of having a seminar or something around Easter. Possibly at the ranch. What do you want me to call it?
No, that's
the farm.
I'm enjoying the term.
I don't know what to call it.
The ranch.
The spread.
Combination of horse shit, cow shit, chicken shit. I mean.
Oh, you have all those animals?
But you have a date?
Put it right for the last one. If a number of people are into it, I'll do it.
Are you talking about
2,154?
No, but are you talking about during the week?
No.
Or on the weekend?
The weekend.
Weekend. Are you talking about Easter weekend?
I better check.
Okay.
I'll let you know tomorrow or Thursday.
Yeah, okay. I don't see any problem with Easter weekend, and there may not be a problem with the weekend before, but I'll know also by Thursday morning, so hope you guys can.
I suspect that either one will be good.
30th and April 7th.
It's before tax time.
BT.
See how much money
you could have gone all night without that.
I know, I gotta do that.
Just because I'm saving $900.
We got thrown into Tartarus, right?
I'm just bad, man.
See, the state doesn't
write that. It's already an IRA. Easy for abandoned.
Hey, I'm sure they've spent the money.
I'm awaiting my return.
Did we get the return?
Yeah,
I'm
going
to film my return.
I'm going to I did.
You're right. Whether you pay tax on it before.
Four, five,
3 years you pay tax on it. It was a shock the first year.
What did you say?
The only thing you pay tax on the interest.
When you drive it?
On the interest only, but not on the front.
But not ongoing, you don't pay tax on it.
How much of it do you think stays in the template from that last one?
Yeah, this doesn't come out, is it?
Yeah.
Well, then, you only pay, the difference between what you put in and what it's worth at the end. That's what you pay tax on.
When you take it out.
An IRA is, or a 401k plan, which is the best, because you pay 401k plan is take it out, and you don't tax at all. Until you use it. And then you get a forward averaging. So you get the average tax you would have over a 10-year period.
No, it would not be fitting for a man of sense to maintain that all company's job as I have described it.
Put one in this year.
Is that right?
You can put it in up to 20% of your income. That means you, if you made that. $30,000 a year.
But that is, or something like it is true, concern our soul and of their abode. Since the soul is immortal, I think he may properly and worthily venture to believe.
What's the point of something?
Devote the soul.
something like it is true concerning our souls and our abodes. That's why we got to work on that side.
Sure.
Therefore, it's an analogy.
This is like being underwater.
I've been there.
This sort of vision, right?
Oh, we need a snorkel.
That may have saved me a question tomorrow. Possibly.
Well, there'll be another one, probably.